decide when is the point to discharge patient about his medical status, is his stable, then we come in with our results and we can show medical staff the different prediction with the features and diagnosis which can lead to readmission. And so why is this readmission so important? Because I will give you an example for the fundamental policy of readmission in Europe and USA. In Europe, readmission is monitorizing, but not so strictly like in USA. In USA, hospital can get financial penalty if number of readmission is higher than above than normal. So, Act Affordable Care was established, and in 2013 to reduce 30 days of readmission for 20%. What happened after 2013? This number of hospitals get financial. They have to pay government because they didn't reduce readmission. For example, 150 hospitals get 1% of loss of their fundings. Our aim of this study was characterization of different mobility-based group of patients based on their prediction performance potential. And our second was identifying groups of patients with high prediction performance potentials. We have three steps in our research. First step was pre-processing. Here we select overlapping subgroups of patients based on two co-occurring disease, and we serve only the subgroups of obtained at least 0.5% of available hospital discharge records. Data was used California State inpatient data, which include ICD-9 codes. I have to say that the ICD-9 codes is approximately 4,000 of them. In this data, they used 10,000 of these codes. In this time, we used data from January 2009 to December 2011. And final data contains was around 5 million discharge records with 16 positive records. This means that readmission happened in 30 days. We also include and exclude some data. We include data, the first readmission for each patient, and exclude data records with no ED number, passenger that died during the hospitalization, patient that were discharged at their own will, and patient younger than 18 years. The second step was modeling. We built a lasso model for prediction of readmission in each diagnosis pair based group. This pair based group I will explain later. And the second and this step was the feature selection. We used stability selection to identify stable feature with positive or negative contribution to prediction performance for each subgroups. Then we've done analysis. We have fundamental five steps. First step was that the analysis of diagnostic coherence was performed using 10% of the most frequent diagnoses in order to conclude 1,061 most frequent diagnoses. Second step was the frequency of coherence was for each pair of diagnosed was calculated, and only the pairs with support higher than 0.5% and less than 10% of positive case were included in the future analyze. The third step was in addition set of 1,061 pillar features representing the presence of the most frequent diseases was added to the initial four features. That's four features I will explain in the next slide. Then last, a base prediction model with five four Lambda was used to build finer classification models on each subset of diagnostic pairs. Then we include equivalence of relative future contribution. If Lasso was positive, we add one. If Lasso was negative, if Lasso coefficient was negative, we remove one. If this happened, we didn't do nothing. This is for the features. And then in the left equivalence, we use this sentence. We random stratify samples repeated with 100 that happened here for 10,000 train and 10,000 test records was used to build and test the classification models. And in the end, we use estimate the prediction performance with area under the rock curve and positive prediction value. Like I mentioned before, I will now explain these initial four features. Before that, I will explain some little density statistics for 3 years. Here we have 3 years is 2009 to 2011. Number of records is average 1.5 million. Number of pairs is of around 450. These pairs mean that this diagnostic was linked. Diagnosis was linked together. For example, the high in the top was diabetes and hypertension. Hypertension, high blood pressure, and this is the four initial features. We have gender, age, length of stay, and number of procedures on the records. And here we can see that how significant difference was. Shown here, in the end we have the missionary rate. You can see that slightly positive trends starting in 2009 with 27% and rise to 29% of readmission. Here we have relative future contribution, which was mentioned before, for age, and only age was stable through the whole period of our research from 2009-2011 in relation to outcome. And here we can see every dot of here is a subgroup of patients represent, and here we can see that line is going up from zero. Similar, we can see in this chart, here we can see relative feature contribution for ICD code, palliative care, and number of chronic diseases. This two feature which was stable to all our research from 2009 to 2011. And here you can see higher than the positive predictive value is the lowest the prediction future contribution is. And here you can see that in this top the line is going down to zero. And here we from zero to above to beyond. And here we can see, here we go from zero to out, and here we go about to beyond zero. Like I mentioned, in step three, we use selective stability, stability selection. And here we have results for 2009 to 2011. We use in this part we show positive, negative, and non-specific numbers. Here we have related to feature and metrics. And here we can see that only age and ICD-9 code urinary tract infection in metrics out was stable to our research and our period, and only a feature number chronic diseases is mentioned here was stable to whole future and whole period of our research. For the work, I will show you in this example. Medical staff, if medical staff has patients with different diagnoses, for example, palliative care, they can use this data from this article, which was wrote in 2014, that palliative care lowers the cost of hospitalization, the rate of admission, and our data, which shows that palliative care is stable to a whole period of time, which we reduce in our research, the patient will stay in hospital and not be discharged, it will happen that later state and number of procedures will increase, but readmission will not appear, and this is more cheaper than that. And the second future work is to build special prediction model for special groups, special subgroup of patients. This is, for example, obesity and chronic diseases together. In this slide, I will read our presentation. This article and this project was this article was founded by this agency. So thank you very much for your attention.
Any questions, comments, or email?
I'm just interested which data you had from the patient. I saw a little bit that you had this, the sex and the number of chronic diseases and whether they had pneumonia. What else did you have?
Is it the ICD-9 codes? Mm-hmm. And these four features. And this is it.
How many ICD-9 codes?
10,000.
This is probably it.
Yes, 2-1. And this is this data we use. So we use California, this,
with readmission, hospital readmission. That is a situation where patient, due to bad diagnosis or bad treatment, needs to return to the hospital for further examination. It is estimated that, as it is reported, that in 2013, every fifth patient returned to the hospital. This costed by, according to this healthcare improvement, about $25 billion. Therefore, it is crucial to identify which patient will return, and possibly, if it's possible, to examine what was the problem with that patient and prevent that readmission. Also, they stated that approximately 76% of readmission can be prevented. That is also a good thing. Motivated this paper. However, data about patients are electronic health records. They just identified binary codes of ICD-9 codes, where ICD-9 code is one diagnosis of that patient. At most, one patient can have 25 diagnoses. Therefore, data for this problem is very, very sparse. And it's hard to identify which relations are good and bad. Researchers often fail to evolve highly accurate models. One reason is rare diseases. About 50% of patients have roughly about 50 diagnoses at most. Other 50% patients have about 400 diagnoses. Those are very rare diseases. And models fail to capture those things. Other things are long and expensive procedures. Due to long procedures, it's very hard to track the patient records. Other problems, though those problems could be solved with data sharing. If hospitals are allowed to share data, they could collect enough data and create a good model. However, hospitals are often not allowed to share electronic records. And a different problem is different healthcare providers hold diagnosis in different ways. Some code with ICD-9 codes, some with CCIS codes. We wanted to solve the problem by oversampling the minority, those patients who have rare diseases. However, due to privacy regulations, we cannot just do oversampling or share data. So we need to create artificial examples in order to be able to share data. So we use something called virtual examples. Those are artificial examples that are similar to the original examples, but not identical, so those data could be shared. And to do so, we use domain knowledge presented in form of ICD-9 hierarchy or ontology, which is a forest of trees stating from higher general concept of diagnosis, something like infective disease, which can be further specified to specify a specific concept or diagnosis. Virtual examples are quite useful, sometimes only possible solution, and they are successfully used in computer vision and also in medical applications, like in Zoran and Bradley's paper for sepsis prediction. ICD-9 hierarchy looks like this. This is just accept from hierarchy. This is a higher level concept. This is a resultados. We use 3-digit hierarchy, so 3-digit material present a group of diseases diagnosis that present the disease of esophagus. They are then specified into more concrete diagnoses, and on the top level, on the bottom level, doctor or medical staff assign these codes. So, our virtual example generator works like this. We get some data from the hospital. We can calculate probability of occurrence of each diagnosis. Because we need to create virtual examples, we do some CD9 code, which is a feature in our example, we add just some fictive count in order to have a probability for some diseases that are not in the current data set. Then we invert probabilities in order to rare diagnosis to be selected for most at the beginning. Then, based on roulette wheel selection, we select diagnoses. Based on comorbidities, we update probabilities of the other diagnoses. And then, combine additive and knowledge-based counting. Knowledge-based counting is something we call, and we utilize two-digit hierarchy. In other words, if there exists comorbidity of selected feature with a group of other features, we update probabilities of that group. So we could randomize features but to belong in the dead group. After that, we check whether we have to stop adding another diagnosis or not. That is done by looking at a data set. If similar data examples exist, we check how many of them are. Have lower number of diagnoses, how much have higher, and again, based on roulette wheel, we select that we select whether we are going to stop or we are going to loop based on select diagnoses. At the end, we add that virtual example to the original data set. Intuition behind this is following. Groups that belong to same group of diagnoses often have same symptoms, same treatment. Therefore, if you mix something, we won't make a big mistake. That can be used, and it will probably help, and we will certainly preserve props. Therefore, we wanted to test our approach. We used, I think, same data as Gregor and Nino. Those are state and patient databases from California, pediatric data, where we selected five general hospitals, because they have the most distance between rare diseases and ordinary patients. And we used 2009-2010 data, which is approximately 45,000 data examples for training, and 2011 for testing, which is approximately 24,000 data examples. We used plain logistic regression just to show a concept. And we evaluated our model using the area under the curve. So, we had the following. We wanted to test what will happen if we just use a logistic regression model on the hospital data, just for that specific hospital. How well will we predict? Then, we used shared data. What if that's a hypothetical situation? If hospitals are allowed to share data, what will happen? And then, again, instead of sharing, we will take examples as many as we want from virtual examples, the examples we have built from that set. It works as following. Every hospital they will provide virtual examples repository with virtual examples from that hospital. We will build predictive models based on hospital data and virtual examples database, and we will get the doctor readmission risk. Based on that risk, doctor will give the diagnosis and we will further update the contract health records. So we got the following results. You can see that original those are models built on hospital level are rather bad. None of them exceed 0.7. However, if hospitals are allowed to share data, we achieve much greater results, much better. And for the first three hospitals, which have the highest amount of patients, we get a better AUC compared. which occur frequently together. Thank you for your attention. So.
Did you test this also with in the real hospitals? I mean, you had this virtual generation of data, I understood. But the thing is, when you give them based on the virtual data, you give some feedback to the doctors. Maybe they say, okay, but these are not our real data.
No, we haven't tested. We have data just tested on us in 2011.
Oh, okay. What doctors will say, because maybe they say, okay, wow, nice what you did, but these are not all real patients.
Yes, all them are.
Okay. Thanks, the next paper will be presented by Milos Juanov. And I think it's a part of models to the ICD-9. I have a theory for predicting pediatric
genes. As you might have guessed by now, we think that reemission is a very important topic. So I'll be speaking about reemission again. So the motivation for studying reemission is, for us, is clear. It's important, it became important economically because hospitals became penalized for having excess readmissions in the US especially. So reducing readmissions is important for hospitals but also for patients because readmission is treated as one of the evaluations of the quality of care. So better, if less readmission means that you have better care at certain hospitals. So how we can do that requires some prediction, as Zora mentioned, for us to make decisions, to make some prediction on who has the most risk of being readmitted. Readmission, I have to just emphasize that it means unplanned return to the hospital. So a lot of returns to the hospital which are planned, we don't count as readmissions in this sense. So the aim of this paper is a little different from the previous ones. We want to make the models interpretable for the doctors and experts. So the models produced by machine learning can be sometimes hard to interpret. There are some efforts in trying to predict patients, and there are reasonable results. This area under the curve is, let's say, good for this domain. But the problem is that these data sets are usually highly dimensional. So the model is just hard to interpret because the many features that are involved in the model prediction. So we wanted to combat this by introducing models which are more interpretable. And one of the reasons why otherwise another problem is that features can be too specific. You saw from previous talks that these diagnoses are identified in the lowest level possible, being more specific for the doctors to diagnose. But for analysis, sometimes these features can be too specific, meaning that there are a certain variant to the disease in a certain context, which means that not many people will have this disease, so will have a low support over this feature. And moreover, we know that doctors aren't sure always which diagnosis they should give to some patients. So there is some ambiguity in the doctors have when assigning these codes. So we know that these features are noisy. Sometimes there are several features, actually the low-level diagnosis that could be assigned to the same patient and somehow it ends up in the database being one of these. So we have to consider that we don't trust these features to be acceptable. So one way to combat this high dimensionality and making it more interpretable is to do classical feature selections. The problem when we try to just select features which are important according to some criteria is that we miss out the interaction between different features. And also feature selections, attribute selections, tend to not be very stable. So we have to repeat the whole process many times. optimized to improve the patient data. Of course, there's a wrapper method which we cannot use because it's a very large data set which we cannot repeat an analysis many times. So we want to build models and do feature selection while building new models. It's called the meta feature selection. And one way to do it is to induce a certain penalty on each selected feature. So one models that each feature that gets selected in the model pays a penalty and that thus has to be really important to be introduced the algorithm. The typical way is to have some loss function. In our case, we use a loss function that was just logistic loss, came from logistic regression, and then put some penalty on the parameters which will tell typical loss, a typical penalty is to use just the square of the parameters, which is called rich. And then, but the problem with this kind of penalty is, yes, it will enforce many data to raise the importance of a feature, but it will not cancel out many features. That means a lot of the features in the model will have small but value, but in cumulative terms, it will be significant for the model. Last regression, which is also well known, will tend to select out some of the features from high dimensions and introduce only features which actually give penalty to features and reduce the weights of the features to actually the weights of the features to the parameters of the model to zero for any insignificant feature. So this is one way to and that's how it's been combated so far, introducing less features and then giving more interpretability. So what we're trying to do is to give this feature more general meaning. So ICD hierarchies are telling us which diseases, which are sometimes very specific, as I mentioned, those belong to the same group of features. This group of features, for example, tuberculosis can be are more stable. More people have this group of diseases than any specific. And also for interpretation, we can more easily say that someone has tuberculosis, and this is the cause of readmission rather than some specific, maybe odd context in which this has occurred. So by reducing this low level to some higher level interpretation, then we will have larger support for each feature that we're using, we'll have less noise, and it will be easier to understand. So one way to build models which take into account these kind of hierarchies is to build these three last-level regularization models. The penalty is a bit different. So according to the hierarchy, we say that a model will have a penalty for introducing a single feature if it doesn't introduce the whole group of features. So we'll say either you say that the whole tuberculosis matters or it doesn't matter, but you don't pick out single instances of tuberculosis as an explanation of your conditions. So this is the kind of penalty that gets imposed. And then, of course, you can explain some prediction by single specific diseases. But you have to overcome all the penalties, so then you will actually have to be very certain that this specific kind of tuberculosis matters and not just having it. So previous use of these kind of penalties were to include some domain knowledge as a prior to guide the model to have a better prediction. So usually people build these hierarchies to improve accuracy or to reduce the need for big data sets to learn these kind of models. In our case, we're using the hierarchy just to guide the model into a space where it can interpret it well. So we're willing to sacrifice some of the accuracy of the model towards some of the model which will be more interpretable. Okay. So we use the hierarchy not to improve accuracy, but to improve interpretability. That's different from previous approaches. So what we gain by applying these kind of penalties, we use the similar data sources as previous ones. I have to mention that we only chose features which are the history of diseases of patients, so we don't include things like demographics. graphics or other procedures or these kind of pictures. So we will interpret which diseases present in a patient are most important for predicting whether the remission will occur or not. So maybe augmenting this with other features will improve accuracy, but for now we just want to see to explain which kinds of diseases are important for patients to get remission. With 851 codes, and we have output which says whether someone will get ready, so it's classification. So we first measure accuracy just for the case to see how much we lose by introducing the kind of penalties. And we don't lose too much. I mean, this is in line with the idea of getting these AOCs. So if we regularize by L1 simply, we lose some of the accuracy, not too much. And select out to select 66% of all the features. If we reduce to 25% of the features, we have to lose some more accuracy. This up-regularization is not much different. So I'm going to show that not using simple L1 but real will not hurt too much of accuracy. But we'll see if it will improve the interpretability much more. So this graph takes some time to explain. So first, on the y-axis, we have different levels of the penalty that we want to the model to have. So the highest is the highest penalty, which only few features will be selected in order to pass the penalty. So we see features which are on the x-axis of all the features that we have available in the model. So we see that different features get selected independently one of the other. But on the also we show here that we group these features according to the hierarchy. So this is one group from the ICD hierarchy. And within that there's dashed lines and we have subgroups of the hierarchy. So we want to see whether whether we can explain the selected features on a higher medical concept. Can we say that we selected these features and that means that having one kind of disease matters and not another kind. And this is result from L1 regularization. And because you have same penalty regardless of the hierarchy, we don't see any shapes in this graph, meaning that selected features that get selected are actually independent, and then we cannot interpret them in higher medical concepts according to the ICD hierarchy. If we use this kind of penalty for three lasso, then we see that some groups of features matter more than others. We see that these groups of features, which are actually neoplasms, are very important for pediatric patients actually predicting their admission. And also, we see that endocrine diseases also have, and among those, not all the subgroups matter, but certain subgroups are more important than others. But this is in terms of groups and subgroups of diseases and not in terms of specific low-level diagnosis, which, as I said, might be noisy or might be too specific with low support. Also, the green dots, I have to explain that green lines mean that it's positive correlation, positive influence, and red negative. So these kind of diseases, the respiratory system, are indicative of the higher readmission with pediatric patients. So we know which groups of features are more important for predicting more or less readmission. Now, when we specialize for a certain groups of patients which have certain diseases, for example, pneumonia, and we are interested in seeing which diagnosis, prior diagnosis in patients with pneumonia are indicative of being readmitted, then we can identify some other features which are of importance. Again, these are features which are high-level features and not a specific low-level diagnosis. So the different kinds of features are of course, those are diseases of the central nervous system and respiratory system, which are most important. But as you see, sometimes you have certain specific diseases pop out as important, but only they break the penalty of being explanatory by themselves not as a whole group. You can pick some other illness and see how remission occurs with this disease. Then we can say that children with epilepsy, of course, if they're diagnosed prior to that with any disease from the nervous center, that can get them a higher chance of being readmitted, which is maybe expected. But it also says that there are certain group of diseases, this one, which is the disease of the digestive system, which might be surprising, and certain subgroup that's highly important in saying which child will be readmitted and which child will not be readmitted. So this is, as I said, this kind of penalty will give us these nicer interpretations, but will not hurt the actors too much. Of course, this is a prediction based only on the prior diagnosis of a patient, including procedures or demographics will improve performance in terms of accuracy. But here we care only about the interpretability of the model. If you have any questions.
Any questions?
I am just curious to know, the end users were the doctors, right?
Yes.
And were they satisfied with the way the data results were analyzed and presented back to them? I mean,
we don't know yet.
This feedback we have not yet.
But at least when we supply the features back to them, we'll have explanations, which is in terms of hierarchy that they understand. So the explanation is guided towards the knowledge they have. If they provide another possibility, having, for example, different grouping of diseases that they consider important, then we can give explanation according to this kind of knowledge. So we use ICD-9 because it's available and doctors use it when giving diagnosis, so they can understand the entire concept from the hierarchy. But we don't have a feedback from them yet.
Again, the same question. Do you plan to sensibilize the sector here, the health sector, with the research that you did with the American data?
Do we plan to?
And to motivate the health sector in Serbia?
Of course. Well, this is preliminary research that is funded by funding agency from Switzerland, and it should be an introductory types of analysis which should lead to some future projects that might motivate a larger audience of this kind.
Okay, so I can tell you one more thing. There is a great incentive for the European Commission to incubate data from areas where data is spread, sparse, and not structured. This is what I'm doing in these countries, right? So do take the opportunity and make a consortium among yourselves and apply, because you have great chances. And so to incubate in a repository in the EU open data repository of database, the health data from these regions, so that it is protected, open, of course, according to their laws, it has to be open, and that these kind of research we have been doing here can also be exploited with your local data. So this would be really something that they would encourage.
If you succumb the barriers that Gregor mentioned with bringing out the data in Europe, it's much harder to acquire data. US is easier. Maybe this kind of research will motivate them to open up some.
Exactly.
Of the
now you have pieces of research already made to show them. And
also in this project there is a repository that is built here in Serbia, and we are populating this repository also with local data, but only maybe from a city hospital we can bring share data, not on the national level like in the US.
Yeah, take a look at Open Data EU and you will see how many of these repositories already exist in many areas.
Yeah.
Also in the health sector there are many, but of course not for your countries. So check that and see. I do
something that is soon to be published. Group hierarchical feature compression and selection method. It's going to be published in Pavia, about half a month ahead. That is an approach where we want to utilize hierarchy and create new feature, and and want to do feature selection on that hierarchy. So first, group hierarchical feature compression and selection. Here it is. We have higher concepts. Let's say infection and parasitic disease. That's a group of about 200 diseases types. It is divided with his correlation into several subgroups. Those subgroups are further divided into specific diagnoses that doctor give to the patient. So we want to create a feature that will represent, for example, tuberculosis, and have some interpretation to the doctor. Therefore, we need some aggregation function of lower level concepts. In this paper, we used sum as a function. We explain this feature, new tuberculosis, how many tuberculosis diagnoses a patient had, and whether this feature is more explanatory than all sub features. This is done by, for example, let's see this. We have this tree. Those are features that are already given. And these three features up top, we create using sum. And we want to select features, not to use all. So we need to compare parent feature with all with child sub features. We use some evaluation measure. In this paper we use gene index and information gain. Have a lower information gain compared on average compared to his parent. Therefore, we can exclude those two features. Parent can explain lower level concepts. However, for example, these three features have higher information gain compared to his parent. Okay, we will delete this feature and join child features to parent of a parent. It will look like this. And we will iteratively go until the hierarchy is flat. And those features are going to be used for the decision tree. Finally, we use some way. Hierarchy is flat, we use those features. However, decision trees often do not perform well. They need to be optimized. So we use something called evolutionary component-based decision trees. Every decision tree can be decomposed to several sub-problems. Most important ones are create split and evaluate split. However, we can add remove significant attributes, stop criteria, and this decision tree pruning. By combining components, we can create algorithms that does not exist anymore. Does not exist, or we can recreate existing ones. But we have a million combinations. It's combinatorial explosion. Therefore, we use evolutionary search to find which component will perform the best. And we used the same data as in my previous paper, Mill's paper, and probably Nina's paper. And compared evolutionary decision tree with C45 and CHAIN object. We had two hierarchies, ICD-9, two ICD-9 hierarchies, default one, and someone called 3-digit hierarchy. And we used two evaluation measures, information gain and gene index. same happened using different evaluation. Better tree, better performing tree, and more interpretable tree. That was done on ICD-9 map, plain ICD-9. Three-digit ICD-9 map. The same results. C45 and CH8 made the scissors stump. They cannot resolve with whether the patient will re-admit or not. Evolutionary decision tree gets much better results with not much greater cost of interpretability. Same result with information. So these are work in progress. We also want to test with other hierarchies and other evaluation measures in order to get better results. And we want to combine with different feature selection and feature compression methods. And that will be done in several months from now. Results are promising. So if you have any comment or question, I will be grateful. So thank you for your attention. Set of data used for testing. We have the outcome and we compare prediction to the outcome.
So based on the experimental data?
Yes.
So let's thank the speaker.
Treatment for a certain disease in a specific hospital, so it's always hospital specific. not too specific, so it is always based on a medical guideline. That means that there were data analyzed from certain, from a lot of hospitals, from lots of patients, and then they give you some advice what you should do in a certain health state, and this is of course the basis of how the doctors work in the hospital, and also that's then the basis of a clinical pathway. And from the literature know that when you have such a pathway and you do not have only your knowledge in mind, it helps a lot in the hospital. For instance, it can reduce the length of stay in the hospital, and also of course it enhances the transparency for patients as well as for new medical doctors who come to the hospital to work there. So when we look at such clinical pathways or clinical processes in the hospital, so we face two main challenges. First challenge is the flexibility. So you do not have just a pathway like that, that you saw, okay, you have certain steps. But of course, for specific patients, it can look quite different. So you can you can have some additional steps that can be done additionally at a certain point of time. Or you can say, okay, this certain step is not necessary in case the patient is very young or in case he has a blood value like this. So it's very, very flexible. And the certain thing is, of course, that what we call big data. So big data, we heard already a lot about this these days. So usually it is volume, variety, and velocity in the business case. But when you look at healthcare, we have other problems. First, the biggest problem is silo, that we also heard from the other talks a little bit. So you have, first you have a lot of data and legacy databases in each hospital. So first, every hospital keeps its own data. So it is, at least in Germany, impossible that you can combine data from different hospitals. It's even not possible to see what other departments in the same hospital are doing, even with the same patients. So that is all data secured. Of course, there are also in certain departments, there are like Excel sheets where you keep data about patients that you collected. You have an access database, you have an SAP system, you have a laboratory system, a lot of systems where data are collected. And usually the department processes somehow the data. So they think, okay, we collected the data, so it's my data, and I do not want to give it away. The second thing is variety, so you do not have all the data that you can save in tables, like this ICD-9 codes and when the patient came, when he left a certain step. But you have, of course, also text data, so doctors are writing medical doctors are writing letters to your doctor at home so that he knows what was done with you. Or you have, of course, image data from computer tomography. And the third thing is, of course, data security, so it is not easy to get such data, especially when you are not working inside the hospital. And of course, all the data have to be anonymized before you can do so. So the challenges here are breaking the silos and also to find out how you can anonymize the data and analyze this huge variety of data. Usually have like in the industry or in the social networks like a petabytes of data, but you have smaller amounts like terabytes only, but the problem is they are not all in your database. What we did was a project in a hospital in Germany, and it was about the pathway creation. That was our starting point. So how we did this? We did it especially for liver diseases, for liver cancer, and for liver transplantation, because this was the specialty of this surgery department. So we found out which doctors and nurses are especially in this field of liver transplantation, for instance. Then we tried to get as much knowledge from them, so that is a real photograph of what we did. So the doctors and nurses stand around and they wrote down what are my steps, and we made the process model out of that. So what was the result is you can see here, so you have a clinical pathway modeled on paper with several chips. Of course later there was one IT person who then modeled the same thing from paper doing it in software for works well for very standardized processes. So we have a production process. You know, of course, what are the steps and what is the beginning, what is the end. In a hospital, you do not have that. It's much more dynamic, much more complex, much more flexible, so it's not so easy. Second problem is not all steps are really in the system. So for instance, in liver transplantation, it is that the liver is centrally, there's a database, and then in the Netherlands, they're sitting there, they are finding out which patient fits for that liver, then they call you. But this call is, of course, it is done, but it is, of course, not in the system here. Of course, also other calls. So, of course, next thing is that, the last decision is always made by the medical personnel, so they make a decision. And, of course, this is also not recorded. Then you have a second diagnosis, so this guy needs a new liver, but what you do actually with this person, the treatment causes the liver for each patient. And what I already mentioned, the data is collected in different clinical information systems, so it's not just using one database and you have results. When we look at the literature, we find several examples that are just three examples that I selected, this process mining was done in several areas like dentistry, breast cancer, and so on. So they already were aware that you have a flexible data, complex data, so what they did usually is a filtering of self-induced steps. So when you have a one or two or three patients who have some special treatment, they just filter them out and said, okay, we don't need to do it. And we see that they were able to find some clinical pathways, but the problem was these pathways were suboptimal, and it was tricky to find handle these flexible pathways so that you can have an additional step or you left just one step out for one patient, and you have also the problems with data quality. For instance, that not all steps were really recorded in the systems. So I thought, okay, I know what others did, but I also wanted to do it on my data. So I used treatment data that were all recorded in an SAP system. So what I had with this some patient ID, also which procedure was done. This is this ICD-9 code we already heard about, and when this process started, when the step started and when it ended. So and then I used the software, this is called DISCO. It is software that was developed in the Netherlands, and it is based on an algorithm which is called fuzzy mining. Fuzzy process mining. The good thing is that it can deal exactly with such huge amount of data. It does some kind of clustering, and it's able to filter out some new steps. So you can have such, that's an example, so it's in German because of course the database was a German one. And then you can see that there were several pathways created, so there's not just one single line, but you see in every step how many patients were there, these numbers, and then for instance from this first computer tomographic investigation, 13 patients went directly to the next step, while 10 patients had two additional steps, for instance. So this sounds also good, but this is already fuzzy mining, so a lot of steps were filtered out, but what was the new feature was this one. So these are really old steps, and you would think, okay, there are tons of patients, now the number of patients, there are just like 300 patients that were here inside, so you see the big flexibility. So, this is a screenshot from Discord. You see that 100% of all pathways, 100% of all activities shown, so you can of course reduce it. But what the doctors wanted, that what they wanted also to learn, are there any specialties? They did not only want the right path, the one and only one. They also wanted to know, are there only side, also sideways. So to conclude, the problem is that we have a very complex and flexible treatment processes that cannot simply be used with just one algorithm and it works. So what we saw that when I use process mining on just my 250 cases, you have a kind of spaghetti processes and it has no value for the doctors. So what a lot of other papers were done was the filtering of seldom used steps, which is one way of doing this. The question is this really always good, or should we not also keep some of these seldom used pathways just to learn something or how treatments done in hospitals? So what should be done is first to build a structured database on the basis of big medical data that we not include only the events, but also some more values, and also that we have to think better about which should be the algorithms that fit, the, fit to the needs of this pathway creation. So, as I told you, it's just at the beginning. I did not invent a new algorithm, that's maybe the next paper next year. So, thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. It was very nice, and actually the audience might have some memories of similar presentation 2 years before. Now, my question is, you want to find, to analyze the decision points.
Yes, so that's one step, because the doctor said that would be of big value for them, that they know what is that. Yeah.
Now, maybe the representation of this one, I mean, with the FASE 9, is not appropriate for checking the decision points, because in this scope, decision points are implicitly represented. I mean, you cannot figure out if this is an AND joint or if this is an XOR gate.
Yep.
So maybe you should consider other representations for the processes, so you can have explicitly represent the decision points, and then you can apply some classification method or some prediction method to those decision points.
Mm-hmm.
Just a comment, not really.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm very happy to have discussion with you.
Oh, that would be nice to get some more ideas. Yeah?
A curious medical question you had said was submitting liver donors.
Yeah.
How that is going to happen?
Oh, it is allowed, at least in Germany or Europe, that when some person doesn't need a new liver, they found it out.
Just
you
cut
have to
the half of the liver?
Yeah, yeah, you
the
can cut a part of the liver and then give it to the person who's in which need. But not everyone can do this, it's only allowed when you are when you are near relative or very near friends, and it's possible. And of course, it reduces the waiting time, because usually you have to wait very long to there is a liver that fits to you.
What's the damage to the living donor of the liver?
Usually, he also has, of course, to stay in the hospital and then to be a little bit careful after that, but he fully recovers usually. And that is therefore you need a longer investigation, because you want to be sure that this person is really, really healthy, and that not that after that he gives half of the liver, that he's then half dead.
And he has to stop drinking alcohol.
Okay, no panic.
And that's a reason to exclude him when they find that the liver is already damaged or he's a drinker or so. That's of course also something.
Thank you.
And it was very funny to see that you also said your work is in the beginning and then you showed us a lot of work done. So
okay.
Is it the German way of presenting or?
Okay, there was one project who dealt only with the manual. Manual creation and support of these pathways, and this project to automatically create this then maybe at the beginning. So I did this pre-analysis, but actually I would like to know some more answers on how this algorithm should look like.
Is it a project that the business university that you are in is engaged, or is it a research from the department?
It is actually my research, because I was before I came to Berlin, I was working in this hospital project, and this is some